So welcome to this week's Inequality and Social Policy Seminar. I'm Chris Winship. My primary appointment is in sociology, but I'm also on the senior faculty at the Kennedy School. This series is made possible by the James M. and Catherine D. Stone PhD Scholars Program in the Malcolm Wiener Center for Social Policy at the Kennedy School. So today we are delighted to welcome Professor Emily of USC Gould School of Law. She will be introduced by Lilly Yu, a PhD candidate in sociology and social policy here at Harvard.
Thanks, Chris. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for being here today. I'm really thrilled to introduce Professor Emily Rio as our speaker this afternoon. Professor Rio is a law professor at the University of Southern California Gould School of Law. She has both a law degree from Harvard Law School and a PhD in sociology from Stanford University. And her scholarship focuses broadly on questions of citizenship and international migration. And she's produced a lot of wonderful work on topics such as immigrant representation, immigrant detention, and immigrants' legal attitudes. And she's published very broadly in both leading sociological and leading law journals using an interdisciplinary lens that spans both quantitative and qualitative methods. So I first became acquainted with Professor Rio's work through my own interest in immigrant legal aid. And her work is really widely referenced by immigration advocates across the country who defend immigrants undergoing deportation and removal. Professor Rio's work has really shined a light on the role that these attorneys play in ensuring that immigrants are able to assert their rights in the U.S. So thank you, Professor Rio, for being here today, and I will let her take it away.
Thank you, Lily, for that wonderful introduction, and thank you, Chris, for hosting me and Pam for making all of the logistics and everything else possible. I'm going to share my screen so I can share my PowerPoint with you that I prepared for today. So if you can bear with me for a second. Let me just preface this by saying, I'm so thrilled to be here, and I'm really excited to be having this conversation with you. I usually present papers that are truly working papers, meaning they're not at all close to being published, and so that way I can get early feedback. And I also circulate my papers before the talk so that you all have a chance to peruse the paper at least. But in this case, the paper recently got accepted at the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. So the paper is going to be released publicly in a couple weeks. Until then, the journal has put a media embargo on it, which means that I'm not allowed to circulate it until it's published, unfortunately. So my plan today is to lay out the paper in the next half hour or so. And again, I'm happy to take any clarifying questions as I go. And then I would love to just get your feedback and any questions you might have, which I would very much appreciate because while, this paper is going to be published soon, this is a line of work that I've been focusing on for some time that I'm going to be continuing on in the future, as I'll talk a little bit more about concretely at the end of this presentation. And that's actually sort of this is true of all of my published pieces in the sense that once I publish something, I'm always sort of thinking about, what the limitations are and what the next natural thing I can do to follow up on those limitations to try to address them in the next project. So with that in mind, I would love to get your feedback that will help me sort of think and rethink about this piece that will then help me to think about the next related projects. So I want to dive right in, and I'd be happy to pause whenever you need me to pause to explain anything further. And before I do anything else, actually, I need to thank the Carnegie Corporation of New York, which provided generous funding to make this project possible, and also the Latin American Public Opinion Poll, which allowed me to carry out the survey administration, the survey experiment that forms the heart or the foundation for this study that I'll be talking to you about today. And let me start by giving you a quick outline of what I'm going to do for the rest of this talk. I understand that not all of you are a captive audience in the sense of being part of the seminar. So I want to sort of give you a little bit of a roadmap to entice you to stay with me the entire time, if possible. So first, I'm going to talk about what the motivations are for the study and what the research questions are. And then I'll briefly describe the new survey data that I collected in collaboration with the Latin American Public Opinion Poll, which is usually referred to as LAPOP. for sure. And then I'll lay out my results from analyzing the survey data. And then I'll end by sharing some thoughts briefly about what I think are some of the broader implications of the study and also some possible directions for future research that I hope to undertake in this area. So let me start with some background and try to explain what the motivations are for the study. So as you all probably are aware, unauthorized migration has been on the news again almost daily. A lot of it focused on the growing number of migrants arriving at the border, at the southern border. Some news outlets are calling this a surge, and others are disputing that characterization and calling it a predictable seasonal pattern. But you know, stepping back a little bit from this news cycle, what is undisputed is that unauthorized migration, or what some of you might prefer to call undocumented migration, of course, is something that has a long history in the United States. So here I'm showing you the total number of apprehensions in the past 10 years or so in the United States, apprehensions of migrants. In 2019, as you can see, the total exceeded a million, according to the Department of Homeland Security. And as a response, U.S. immigration enforcement policy has generally grown increasingly tougher and more punitive over the years, especially beginning in 1996 when Congress passed what's called the Illegal Immigration Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act, which is a mouthful, so for short, IRA-IRA. Now, I know that some of you are migration scholars and very familiar with IRA-IRA and the consequences of IRA-IRA, but I don't wanna assume knowledge of immigration law on the part of the rest of you. So let me just quickly explain two features or two key enforcement policies that emerged through IRA-IRA as a critical enforcement tool for the US government, which is actually the focus of this study. So the first of these enforcement tools is immigration detention. As many of you might know, immigration detention has actually existed long before the enactment of IRA-IRA, but it expanded greatly post-1996 with the passage of IRA-IRA because that law broadened the list of crimes that could trigger removal proceedings and also the category of non-citizens who became subject to what's called mandatory detention. Now, immigration detention, as many of you might also know, it's supposed to be strictly civil confinement and has this narrow purpose of facilitating the US government efforts to remove migrants. But in terms of where and how detention takes place in the interior of the United States, it's indistinguishable from criminal incarceration because the confinement itself takes place in actual jails or jail-like facilities if it's a facility that's devoted to immigration detention, and these facilities are across the United States. The second policy tool that I'm gonna focus on is what's called summary removal. And this is basically a fast-track, streamlined deportation procedure that allows the US government to deport or to remove certain non-citizens from the United States without a hearing before an immigration judge, so no judicial review. And that means the decisions are made by low-level on-the-ground immigration officials who are essentially serving as both prosecutor and judge at the same time. And they have virtually unchecked authority to investigate and to charge and to make decisions all within a very short amount of time, usually a course of a day. And given the speed with which this process unfolds, which is why it's called summary removal or expedited removal, there's rarely any opportunity for the immigrant respondent who is subject to this procedure to collect any kind of evidence or to consult with an attorney or anyone else, actually, for that matter, before that decision is made. So those are the two key enforcement tools that became extremely important post-1996. In terms of detention, what I'm showing you here is the growth in the detained population over time. So in 2019, the total number of bookings exceeded 510,000 migrants. And an important rationale that the US government has advanced for why we need detention is this idea of deterrence. And so what that means is the government has basically argued that detention sends an important message to prospective migrants who are still in their home countries that, you know, our border is not open to illegal migration, and that if they were to come, that they should not be expecting to be just released into the United States. And that's actually exactly what the Secretary of Homeland Security said back in 2014 during the Obama administration. So this, you know, policy has been in place in terms of the deterrence rationale for a long time. And the same deterrence rationale is also what led to the zero tolerance policy that some of you are probably very familiar with, that took place at the southern border in 2018 during the Trump administration, when thousands of families were, children were separated from their parents and placed in separate detention facilities. Now, in terms of summary removal, which is also what I call non-judicial removal, this, I'm showing you the overtime trend for that process. And what this figure basically shows you is a breakdown of removals by type. And I'm showing you here two most common types of summary removal or non-judicial removal. And so one is called expedited removal, which are the green bars here. The other is called reinstatements, which are the orange or yellow bars here. Yellow, I think. I'm a little colorblind. I think these are orange or yellow, I'm not sure. And then the gray bars here are all other types of removal, the residual category. And so what I wanna just highlight here is, you know, these two types of removal, expedited removal and reinstatements, make the bulk of the removals that take place. And they, you know, combined, they always exceed all other types of removal, again, which are the gray bars. And just like immigration detention, the US government has expressly stated over and over that expanding summary removal procedures actually should create a powerful deterrence effect of deterring migrants or prospective migrants from trying to enter the United States. So in this study, I was interested in looking at the potential consequences of these policies on deterrence. Again, the extent to which these kinds of policies might be discouraging prospective migrants from engaging in unauthorized migration in the first place. And I also wanted to understand these policies' effect on something else, quite unrelated to deterrence, which is what I call migrants' legal attitudes. And by legal attitudes, I mean how individuals in their countries of origin come to think about these policies in terms of fundamental fairness issues. So more specifically, what I focus on are how prospective migrants might view our immigration system's procedural justice, distributive justice, and interactional justice. In other words, you know, I wanted to understand how prospective migrants might think about the fairness of procedures that are used, the outcomes of that process, and the nature of and the quality of international and interpersonal interactions that migrants might have with U.S. immigration enforcement authorities. And by the way, these three legal attitudes that I've highlighted here, they're the main types of justice evaluations that scholars most often examine in terms of people's attitudes toward legal authorities and legal systems. And the reason why it's so important to understand these types of attitudes is because, for one thing, these types of value judgments and assessments or evaluations are, you know, highly predictive of people's willingness to accept the decisions of legal authorities in whatever context, or to cooperate with legal authorities and to engage with the legal system in the first place. And you know, in the context of understanding how people in their origin countries, in their home countries, might think about US laws, you know, I think that this, you know, issue of trying to understand legal attitudes takes on an added significance, or at least that's what I argue, because these attitudes abroad can really impact, I think, international politics in all sorts of ways. And the US government's ability to assert some kind of moral authority or leadership on global issues like human rights, like, you know, the rule of law. So what I argue is that understanding these types of legal attitudes can have really important implications for both not just domestic governance for us, but also international governance. All right, so I set out to conduct a field experiment in close collaboration with the Latin American Public Opinion Project, LAPOP, which basically conducts an extensive public opinion poll in North America, Central America, South America, and also a significant number of countries in the Caribbean. And the project is basically housed at Vanderbilt, but it has a lot of international partners across the world. So working with her team, both in the US and abroad, I developed an experimental module that was placed on the latest round of survey administration, which is the 2018-2019 America's Barometer. That's the name of the public opinion poll. So America's Barometer, really quickly, it's a really long-standing, methodologically rigorous survey project that covers a whole host, very wide-ranging political and social topics that are of interest and relevance in these various countries across the Americas. And except for the surveys that are done in the US and Canada, all of the surveys are conducted face-to-face. And only one respondent per household is interviewed for the survey. And all of the, and the samples are, because they're developed using a multi-stage probabilistic design, that results in nationally representative samples of voting age adults in these countries. So for this study, for the experimental module, we focused on top four countries of origin in terms of unauthorized migration to the US. So here I put up a figure that shows you how apprehensions in the United States break down by countries of origin. So you can see Guatemala is orange here, light blue is Honduras, dark blue Mexico, and El Salvador is light green here. And then all other countries, the residual category is a dark gray at the top. So you can see by far these four countries of Guatemala, Honduras, Mexico, Salvador constitute the largest, flow of undocumented migration to the US. And that's been the case if you look at it from a sort of a historical perspective. So from that viewpoint, and also the sheer volume of migration to the US, these four countries are the ones that became the obvious choice of focus for this study. So for the experimental module, which I'll go over in a minute in terms of the content, it was administered to over 6,100 individuals, again, across the four countries. And I'm showing you here the breakdown in terms of the total sample size for each country, which was roughly equal across the four countries. And the module went through several rounds of pre-testing in each of the countries. And I'm going to show you the basic study design before I get into the specific items that were placed on the module. So in the four countries, in the, each of the four countries, the survey contained three experimental conditions. This is what I call the control condition, the detention condition, and the court condition. And these, the contents I'll explain in a second, but just in terms of the basic design, the respondents were randomly assigned to each of the conditions, and they were stratified by their level of US social ties. And so to do that, we first asked, do you have any close friends or close relatives currently living in the United States? That's the part that I just highlighted in red. And then we assigned a third of the random sample of those who answer yes to that question to the control condition and another third random sample to the detention condition, and then another third random sample to the court condition. And we did the same for people who answered no to this US ties question. And again, for those who answered don't know. So the basic rationale for the stratification process in terms of stratifying the random assignment this way was, well, we know that prospective migrants' intentions to migrate to the United States and also their legal attitudes might be substantially related to the extent to which they have social connections to individuals in the US. So by stratifying the random assignment of survey respondents to the experimental conditions, we were able to ensure that a roughly equal number of respondents within each level of US social ties would be exposed to the three experimental conditions. And that way, you know, we can do things like meaningfully control for that potential confounding factor. The next step, the respondents then rated their level of agreement or disagreement with statements that were designed to measure their legal attitudes relating to how they viewed procedural justice, which is what I call process, the variable process here. Distributive justice, which is captured by this variable outcome. And then interactional justice, which is captured by this variable respect. And I'll explain in a second what these theoretical concepts are and how the measurements are designed to capture them. And then finally, the survey asked the respondents about their intentions to migrate to the United States, and that's the US migrate item here. Okay, so let me show you the experimental conditions, starting with the control condition. And in this condition, what the interviewer did was to read this statement that I'm showing you here, which is a relatively brief statement. It says, in the past 12 months, US immigration authorities apprehended thousands of Mexicans. And thinking about these Mexicans, how much do you agree or disagree with the following statements? This bracketed Mexicans is here just to highlight for us that this obviously changes with each country. So might say, you know, Guatemalans, Hondurans instead of Mexicans, depending on what's the survey country and so on. Now the detention condition looked like this. It says in the past 12 months, US immigration authorities apprehended thousands of Mexicans and placed them in detention facilities or jails for days, weeks, or months. And then thinking about these Mexicans, how much do you agree or disagree with the following statements? So that's the detention condition. And then finally, the court condition, what the interviewer read was this. In the past 12 months, US immigration authorities apprehended thousands of Mexicans and did not give them an opportunity to present their cases before an immigration judge. Thinking about these Mexicans, how much do you agree or disagree with the following statements? So the differences across the experimental conditions are relatively subtle, which is why I highlighted the slightly different languages across the conditions in red for you. But basically, the differences are that the control condition, you know, explained only that many of the respondents' co-nationals were apprehended by immigration authorities. And by contrast, the detention condition made salient to the respondents that many of those apprehended co-nationals faced immigration detention for an indefinite period of time. And then this court condition that you're looking at, what that made salient was the lack of judicial process available to many co-nationals after they get apprehended. And I should note all of these statements across the experimental conditions are an accurate description of the enforcement policies that are in effect at the time of the survey, which is actually still true today. Now, the next step in the experiment is that after the interviewers read to the respondents the prompts that I just introduced to you, they were asked to express their agreement or disagreement with a number of statements about their legal attitudes toward the US immigration system. And I developed these items based on existing surveys that are used in, you know, there's a long line of research on legal attitudes and a lot of that work is done through surveys. And so these items were adapted from those surveys. So let me just quickly define these theoretical concepts and the survey items that we use to operationalize those concepts. So first, judgments about procedural justice, what they focus on is legal authorities' decision-making process, which you know, things like the consistency or the neutrality of the process. And here's how we measure that concept. The survey basically asked the respondents to rate their agreement or disagreement with the statement, generally speaking, Mexicans who are apprehended by US immigration authorities go through a fair process. And distributive justice is different because it focuses on outcome fairness, which relates to the degree to which an outcome is consistent with or can be justified by some kind of a reference standard, whatever that standard might be. And you know, what past research shows is that people's evaluations about outcome fairness is distinct from what's called outcome favorability, which is simply about whether or not people, you know, get what they want, right, in terms of outcome, and outcome that is favorable to them. So it's possible for individuals to receive an unfavorable outcome, but still, you know, judge that outcome to be fair because, for example, it comports or accords with their conception of equity or need or merit, or whatever the reference standard might be. And here's how we measure the assessment of distributive justice by giving them the statement, generally speaking, Mexicans who are apprehended by U.S. immigration authorities receive fair outcomes. And then finally, the last type of fairness perception has to do with what's called interactional justice, which, you know, basically reflects the degree to which people believe that they're treated with, you know, dignity, with politeness, with respect by the authorities that they interact with, or you know, whoever the legal authorities that are involved in executing the relevant procedures or determining the outcomes in their cases. And we measure that concept by asking people to rate their agreement or disagreement with this statement. Generally speaking, Mexicans who are apprehended by US immigration authorities are treated with respect. And each of these justice items were administered using a 7-point scale that I put up here from strongly agree to strongly disagree. So higher the value, the higher the level of disagreement. And then the last component of the experimental module was designed to capture people's intentions to migrate. So for that, we used a 4-point scale, not at all likely to very likely. And we asked, speaking of the United States, how likely is it that you will go to live or work in the United States in the next 3 years? Okay, so here's a list of covariates that I used in the analysis. Some of these are just collected, you know, as a matter of routine for the survey, and others were put there specifically for the purposes of this study. Those were the US ties variable, the extent to which the respondents have US social ties. This income variable also was put there specifically for this study, which basically measures perceptions of how people think about the adequacy of their household income. And then crime victimization in the countries of origin, to what extent, how many times they've experienced crime victimization in the past 12 months. And then again, the rest are standard battery of items that always get included in the America's barometer, like gender, age, education, and so on. Okay, so now I'll share some key findings from the study and wrap up. So first, here are the results that I'm showing you on the bivariate tests of the relationship between the experimental conditions and the respondents' expressed intentions to migrate to the United States. So basically trying to understand the treatment effect on intentions to migrate. And what this figure basically shows you is that the pattern of expressed intentions to migrate is almost identical across the experimental conditions. So for example, you know, regardless of the condition that they were exposed to, about 60% of the respondents in each condition answered that they were not at all likely to go live or work in the United States. About 21% answered that they were a little likely to go. About 10% across the conditions said that they were somewhat likely, and another 10% said that they were very likely. So In other words, you know, making salient the possibility of immigration detention, lack of judicial review in the removal process, that did not have a significant effect on people's intentions to migrate. Now, some of you might be thinking, and this is what I thought about, it's possible that to the extent that there's any deterrent effect, that deterrent effects can vary for different groups of individuals, particularly depending on their, you know, motivations for migrating and their capabilities for migrating. So for example, you know, prospective migrants with family ties in the US may be less deterrable, right, than people without those kinds of ties, to the extent that family ties might be, you know, people with family ties might be motivated by a strong desire for family reunification or because their social ties represent social capital in the United States that could serve as some kind of a buffer against risks of apprehension and so on. So to explore those kinds of possibilities, I carried out a set of regression analysis where I looked at the interaction effect between the experimental conditions and certain group characteristics of the respondents. And the idea was to see whether the treatment effect on intentions to migrate varied by the respondents' US social ties, for example, is the one that I'm showing you here. So these are looking at the conditional marginal effects of the treatment on intentions to migrate, which is represented by the US migrate variable at varying levels of US ties. So never, rarely, once or twice a month, once or twice a week, every day is a level of to what extent they the respondents communicate with you know, close relatives or friends that they might have in the United States. And as you can see, none of these conditional marginal treatment effects are statistically significant or different from zero. All of them cross the zero line here. And the results are the same for some of the other variables that I looked at in terms of interaction effects. So here I'm showing you the conditional marginal effect, treatment effect on US migrate at varying levels of respondents' experiences of crime victimization. So on the x-axis, you have the frequency of crime victimization. And you can see that they're all pretty much flat in terms of crossing the zero line. And the same is true for varying levels of income adequacy. So none of these conditional marginal treatment effects are statistically significant. Now turning to the second outcome, which are the legal attitudes. I'm showing you the regression results, and models 1, 3, and 5 are baseline models that just have the treatment conditions. And then models 2, 4, and 6 include all of the covariates that I listed for you earlier on. And here, what I just wanna emphasize is just looking at the coefficient or the odds ratios for the experimental conditions. And what this shows you is that, you know, for the respondents in the detention condition, this line here, the odds of expressing more negative assessments about the procedural fairness of US immigration enforcement policies, that's this column here. So these two odds here you should focus on. Those odds in terms of negative assessments of procedural fairness are greater than those who are in the compared to those who are in the control condition. And the odds of their expressing more negative assessments about the outcome fairness, that's this column and this column here, also greater compared to those who are in the control condition. And then you'll note that there's no significant treatment effects on the respondents' assessments about interactional justice, which is represented by this column and this column. And also no significant treatment effect on any of the legal attitudes in terms of the court condition. And I'd be happy to talk about what I think might explain some of these null findings during Q&A if that might be of interest to you. But I'm going to try to wrap up by trying to summarize what these findings might mean and also where I might go next. So what the findings with respect to the treatment effect of the detention condition that I've highlighted for you in the previous slide suggest is that, you know, a heightened awareness about the widespread use of immigration detention may, I think it might foster delegitimating beliefs about the US immigration system, you know, specifically in terms of our system's, you know, procedural fairness, our outcome fairness, And at the same time, there may be little to no deterrent effect, which again is the primary rationale for having these policies in the first place, at least from the policymaker's perspective. And in terms of future directions, I'll just share a couple starting thoughts on what I think might be some important avenues for continuing research. So for one, you know, this study is unique in the sense that it's the first study that uses a randomized experiment to try to measure deterrence and legal attitudes. And, you know, there are important advantages to that design. The key one being our ability to draw causal inferences, of course. But at the same time, you know, experiments are only a first step in helping us to unpack the complexities of you know, any kind of social phenomenon, including this one. So I think there's still a lot that we don't know about the relationship between these kinds of policies and their potential deterrent effects. You know, I didn't set out to measure the respondents' existing level of knowledge about the US enforcement policies, for example. And it's possible that while, you know, knowledge about the prevalence of certain kinds of enforcement policies, like detention, may have a significant deterrent effect, knowledge about the, that it might not have a significant deterrent effect, knowledge about the severity of the perceived punishment might have some deterrent effect, we don't know, right? So for example, knowledge about the length of detention or the conditions of detention, those are the kinds of things that I didn't and wasn't able to look at in this study. You know, but that actually leads to the second line of inquiry that I think is interesting and important that I've highlighted here, which is, you know, we should also want to understand what specific aspects of certain enforcement policies might trigger negative fairness evaluations about our system, and also how those value judgments are then, you know, transmitted intergenerationally and across social networks, across communities, to generate, you know, distrust or cynicism about the legitimacy of our immigration system that can have really enduring effects beyond the life cycle of particular enforcement policies that policymakers are really focused on, especially with respect to its deterrence effect, but it, in large part are overlooking these kinds of other less, you know, perhaps measurable aspects in terms of how people come to be legally socialized into thinking about the normative aspects of our policy. So I'll stop there, and I'd love to hear your thoughts and comments.
Thank you very much, Emma. Most interesting research. So let's open it up for questions.
That is the climate issue. And I'm just, because it's almost never addressed by the journalistic coverage.
So I agree with you that, you know, climate refugees, that entire phenomenon has been on the rise and is a real important issue that has not received as much attention as it should, as one of the important factors that push migrants from their home countries into the United States. And, you know, I think we've seen, we're sort of increasingly seeing the consequences of ignoring that issue. And a lot of the natural disasters that have devastated these traditional sending communities that then push people out, there's definitely an important linkage there that I think, I know a lot of scholars are now becoming more and more interested in documenting that relationship. But in terms of sort of from a policymaking standpoint, I think the policymakers have a difficult time, generally speaking, of trying to draw the you know, a straight line between the two dots in order to come up with concrete policies that might be able to somehow address that problem in a way that they can see as fitting neatly within the deterrence policy. And so to the extent that deterrence sort of is the main key rationale that sort of undergirds a lot of our enforcement policies, I think you know, it's very difficult for people to move away from that framework to think about issues like climate change that can then lead to a growing out migration as people try to sort of, you know, manage and deal with, you know, natural disasters that then lead to economic devastation and so on and so forth. So I agree that that is a really important issue that we need to be looking at going forward.
Okay, we have a question from Lillian Bobia.
Yes, thank you so much. Sorry. First, thank you, Dr. Rhea, for this presentation and also the sociology department that is organizing this. My question: I am a member of the working group on mercenaries and PMSC. We at the UN just wrote a report on immigration, and we focus also on the situation in the U.S. And my question, since you are looking at the future lines, what is your, I don't know if you have, if you got any kind of perception about what is the perception that they could have regarding the distribution of justice when they are dealing with detention centers that are administrated by private security that are privatized. You mentioned at the beginning, you make a parallel of how this detention looks like precisely more like our prisons in the United States. And as you know, President Biden just making a change in the situation of the federal prisons regarding the privatization. So we actually wrote to him asking for that could be extended to the detention centers. And I wonder if this is a variable that you think that it will be important in terms of the perception that, you know, immigrants could think that actually the state is not the only one that has the monopoly or the control of the detention rules in the United States because of the level of privatization. And in the same regard, my second question that derived from there is, how do you think that the fact that the separation of kids from their parents fell into also that same category, not of deterrence, but actually injustice, the vision of injustice they could have on the system?
Yeah, so thank you for those questions. I'll address the first one first. That question goes beyond this particular study, but I have looked a lot at the development of privatization of immigration detention in the United States and the growing market monopoly by for-profit companies that are taking over these facilities. And at the same time, though, there's also been a lot of attention that I think we should be paying attention to that we haven't as much on the role of counties and local jurisdictions in entering into agreements with ICE to operate these facilities, who are also in some ways profiting from that involvement. And so I think the profit motive isn't necessarily unique to for-profit companies. And in some sense, you know, this is something that hasn't been studied as much in terms of your question about how those kinds of arrangements, that type of a for-profit making type of arrangement in the immigration detention system might be perceived by the migrants themselves who are confined in these facilities. That's a really important question that, you know, I've only begun to sort of scrape the surface in terms of what those perceptions might be like and how they might be changing over time. What I do know is that at least among the detainees that I've done field work with over in the past, several years, is that one, there's a widespread perception that, you know, detention in many ways, like I talked about, is a money-making operation, not just for private companies, but also for the government in general. And some of that perception is tied to how the bail hearings unfold and the sheer sort of high amount of bail that's imposed on immigrants to be released from detention. And you know, I think some of that sort of becomes foundation for a lot of detainees to come to think of detention as this sort of revolving door type of an institution where either the government or private entities are making money off of them. And so in that sense, it can have, I think in many ways that system viewed from that perspective can have really devastating delegitimating effects in terms of how the detainees think about the legitimacy of the system, if there is one to begin with at all. And in terms of you know, whether or not the conditions that detainees face within these facilities vary by whether the facility is operated by private for-profit companies, I think there's a lot of mixed empirical data. And it's hard to parse, partly because that kind of data is, for one, hard to come by, largely because these facilities are very non-transparent and they don't release a lot of information publicly. And it's impossible to actually get really reliable data over time on conditions, questions. And so, you know, in the work that I've done in the past, where we've looked at the types and the number of complaints that are filed in privately operated facilities versus non-privately operated facilities, we have found that the number of complaints are higher in private facilities. But that might be due to the type of facilities that tend to be operated by for-profit companies. So there's a lot of complexities there that I think relationships that that need to be parsed that is difficult to do right now. In terms of separation of kids that happened and is still ongoing actually at the border, although we don't hear about it as much. I've done a recent study on looking at kids who fall into the custody of the Office of Refugee Resettlement, which is part of the Department of Health and Human Services, which is different than the jurisdiction that that ICE has over adult migrants who are apprehended. And you know, there's even debates about whether ORR custody constitutes detention. But insofar as they're in congregate settings, I think there's very little doubt that they're equivalent to detention. And to the extent that things like practices like family separation and how we treat unaccompanied minors who end up in the custody of you know, Office of Refugee Resettlement for long periods of time in these kinds of congregate settings, I think they also have the type of what I think of as unintended effects in terms of how people come to think about the legitimacy of our system and come to sort of distrust of the basic fundamentals of fairness about our system. And so I think in some ways they have the similar type of effect in terms of our treatment of children in the system as our treatment of adult population in our system.
Thank you so much. I wanted to first say thank you for this research and especially commend you in doing this research for a very, very difficult time that we have with immigrants. And I'm just curious if you think that these results will be would be the same if you did this after the Biden administration, because when I think about attitudes, I think about what people experience from family members that they may have that come here versus what the media is saying. And if the media starts to look a little different in the next 3 years or so, I'm just curious if you think that how this will affect these attitudes.
Yeah, so, you know, that's a really interesting question, given that a lot of things have, in some sense have, you know, changed, obviously with the new administration. But in other ways, I think, well, I think it's too early to tell in terms of where Biden policy might be going in terms of immigration. So for at least with respect to these particular domains of enforcement that I'm interested in this study. So, for example, you know, the Biden administration ended the Remain in Mexico policy officially, but it's retained the Title 42 expulsions, right, that are based on the public health reasons for closing the border to migrants. And instead of having a, you know, Remain in Mexico now, it's become a Wait in Mexico policy. And certainly the Biden administration has promised a more humane approach to migration. But, you know, the vast majority of unauthorized migrants, you know, as soon as they enter, are still continuing to be turned back or expelled through these kinds of summary procedures that I talked about today. And, you know, in terms of detention, the Biden administration has set up makeshift camps for unaccompanied minors whose numbers have been rising in recent months and have been, even though it has shut down a family detention facility in South Texas, you know, ICE has continued to assure us that all of the detention, sort of that institutional system that's in place for detaining migrants is still fully functional and operational. And so I think it's important for us to, at least in this early stages of how the administration might be working, to not sort of overstate the changes that might or might not be taking place. And you're right that the media framing of what the Biden policy might be, you know, ultimately might have a very important effect on how migrants come to think about our enforcement system. But ultimately, I think it's the actual policies and their real impact that will have consequences in terms of how migrants' legal attitudes are shaped, rather than solely how the media frames might be shaping the way they come to think about, for example, their chances of entering the United States and therefore their intentions to migrate, and how they ultimately might come to think about our system in terms of sort of value judgments that they might form.
I think we have time for one last question. Evan, do you want to ask your question?
Absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing your time with us today. I'm really interested in how you think about the varying immigration landscape in the United States internally by different jurisdictions, states, counties, different things like driver's licenses being differently available, and the concern that a routine traffic stop or like racial discrimination of drivers could devolve into deportation, or funding for immigration attorneys or provision of immigration attorneys differing by jurisdiction, cooperation with ICE against witnesses or victims of crime. Like, how does this variation internally impact procedural justice or views on procedural justice?
Yeah, so you're raising a question that I haven't personally been able to address through this line of work, but certainly as you pointed out, there's an enormous variation in terms of how local jurisdictions are managing and addressing issues related to migration and their migrant population, although immigration law, as we know, is federal law, and you know, federal agencies play an outsized role in terms of actual enforcement. But you're raising a really important question, because to the extent that we're interested in how migrants who are already in the United States experience their daily lives as they go about, you know, their work and raising their families, et cetera, within the confines of these local laws and ordinances that might be affecting things like what you talked about, right? Ability to obtain driver's license and so on. You know, I have no doubt that those kinds of local policies are having a tremendous impact in how different populations across the country are forming their views about procedural justice, but not only procedural justice, but also outcome fairness and what we talked about in terms of interpersonal interaction with justice. And so I think you're right that it's important to break it down in terms of how local variations might be playing a really important role, to the extent that these migrants are tied to people overseas in their home countries that then might be having an effect of diffusing the type of attitudes that they come to possess abroad, right? So that's that process, I think, is something really interesting and important that we need to keep our eyes on in terms of understanding the sort of that diffusion process, right, from the United States to in local communities to abroad.
Great. Well, thank you, Emily, for a terrific talk. So I'll give her a big hand.
I'll stick around in case.
Okay, and she's available for 10 minutes or so for any PhD students who would like to meet with her and talk.